Welcome to the Algebra 2 Chapter 4B review. This is the 2018 edition. We've made some revisions, as we do every year. So this reflects the current changes we made it to this chapter. Let's get started, right? We're finishing up our polynomial function extravaganza. So our review opens up with, at most, how many zeros could this function x plus 4 to the fourth power have? How many zeros does it actually have? Describe what's happening in the graph at that point, or at those places. Okay. So this is basically saying we've got the fundamental theorem of algebra, right? And fundamental theorem of algebra says that the number of zeros that a function has is dependent upon its degree. Well, if we were to expand all of this out, we would have x to the fourth power and then some collection of terms afterwards. So the key is that's a fourth degree. It has four zeros, either real or imaginary or repeated zeros. Okay? So that's what the potential is because of fundamental theorem of algebra. Secondly, how many zeros does it actually have? Well, think about that function, x plus 4 to the fourth. If I were to factor that all out, the solution I'm going to keep getting is x equals negative 4. So it only has one zero, which seems to disagree with the fundamental theorem of algebra because fundamental theorem says that we should be having four zeros. However, we talked about this concept of multiplicity, that zeros can be repeated if their factors are repeated. And that's what we see here. Because we have that x plus 4 factor to the fourth power, it means I see that zero, x equals negative 4, four times. Since it's an even number of times that I see that result, that would be shown in the graph as a touch point, where the graph does not cross the x-axis, merely touches it and bounces off. So really that question number one, if we're looking for the test, it's interpreting the fundamental theorem of algebra. Can we do that? Do we know that the fundamental theorem says that the number of zeros of a polynomial matches its degree? Problem number two, list all of the possible rational zeros. There are some key terms here that I want to be sure we catch because students end up doing too much work on problems like this. First of all, it says list. Okay? Then it says rational. Okay? A list. If we make a grocery list, we're going to separate those things by commas, right? We are listing them all out, and they are rational. Rational numbers are ones that we can express as fractions. So this wants all the possible fractions that could zero out this polynomial. And to find those possibilities, we look at the factors of our constant, in this case, 1, 2, 4, 8, and 16, and the factors of our leading coefficient, 1, 2, and 4. All right, and the reason for this is very much like when we factored trinomials that had a lead coefficient, not one. All of our solutions came from taking a piece of the end over a piece of the beginning. So we're just expanding that to work with higher degree polynomials. Here's what we need to know is how to set up all those possible combinations. So I'm just going to make a little like a list generator here where I say, okay, I got 1, 2, 4, 8, and 16 as my possible numerators. And then 1, 2, and 4 coming out of that 4, those are my possible denominators. And then I just need to write it as a list. So I could have plus or minus 1 over 1, 1 over 2, 1 over 4. Again, that's working with 1 over all the different possible denominators. Then we'll move on to the next one. And if I catch something that simplifies, I don't need to list it again. So actually, this 1 over 1, why don't I simplify that just to just be plus or minus 1? Okay, next, 2 over 1. I don't have that on my list yet. 2 over 2, got it. 2 over 4, got it. Next, 4 over 1, don't have that one yet. 4 over 2, got it. 4 over 4, Got it. Next one. Eight. Or sorry. Yeah, we just handled the four. Next is eight. Eight over one. I don't have that. Eight over two. Got that. Eight over four. Got that. Okay. And finally, let's look at 16. I do not have 16 over one. I do have 16 over two, and I do have 16 over four. So this list of things is the answer we're looking for in a problem like that. Now, we saw in a quiz often these problems, because they take so long to generate and work through the possibilities, it's such a menial task, such a small task that, if you have the pattern, this is typically represented as multiple choice. And we saw that on our quiz earlier this chapter as well. So we should be prepared for that. Quiz would be a good thing to study if we have any concerns. Next, the big section, find all of the zeros. When we talked about this is kind of what connects the chapter 4A with 4B. So with this one, finding all the zeros, can we factor it? And if we can, then can we furthermore use synthetic division? Can we use things like quadratic formula? All the zeros, they could be real, they could be imaginary. This is where the fundamental theorem will really help us ensure that we found everything. So I'm going to point out what I think are the fastest, but realize that you could be approaching this in a different way based on what you find in the calculator or what you find as working out here. So for number three, I noticed that that is a sum of perfect cubes. That's what we covered in chapter 4A. This is factorable. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to factor that out and set it equal to zero. Well, 1x. I can factor that using the sum of perfect cubes. And again, that's what we covered in chapter 4A. And since it's factorable, this first factor is an easy solution, x equals negative 1. The second factor is one that I just need to use quadratic formula on. Opposite of b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac. It's 4 times 1 times 1 all over 2a. And some students have really been struggling with the simplifying the very end of quadratic formula. I'm going to revisit that right here to hopefully help review that concept. If I simplify the square root, it's an imaginary root because we have a negative underneath a radical. And then I'm looking for all three pieces that are not under the radical. Can I divide those by the same number? I cannot. So 1 plus or minus I root 3 all over 2. That represents my plus or minus two other solutions. So I've got one, two, three solutions for a third degree polynomial. Fundamental theorem says I'm done. For number four, I notice it's a fifth degree, so I should be finding five zeros. And I do notice that I can factor this early on. This one's factorable. Right, so first I'm going to take a GCF of x out. Ooh, and I can factor that further. What's left behind in parentheses after that GCF of x is taken out is something that takes quadratic form. I can use magic numbers. And I can factor that even further because we've got a difference of perfect squares. I cannot factor this any further, though, because it is addition, not a difference of perfect squares. It is a sum. Cannot factor that. The nice thing is I get x equals 0, x equals negative 3, x equals positive 3. Coming out of those first three factors, those were very easy to spot. I should also mention that at this point right here, you could just set x squared minus 9 equal to 0 and solve by square roots. You would still get the solutions we got underneath. So it did not specify that you had to factor completely. And you may be using synthetic division with this one. That's fine. We'll talk about how that could also be done in, repeated synthetic division, how that could also be done once we get to number six. Anyway, I'm getting ahead of myself. The last factor we have to solve is this x squared plus 1. Where does that zero out? All right, this is all set equal to 0 as I factor. I'm trying to find the zeros. I would subtract 1 from both sides and then square root both sides plus or minus square root of negative 1. that's plus or minus I, because by definition, square root of negative 1 is I. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 solutions, 5 zeros for our fifth degree polynomial. It checks out. Problem number 5, I noticed there are 4 terms there, so I may try to factor by grouping, but I'll quickly find out that grouping does not work here. So we're not able to leave the same quantity in parentheses, so factor by grouping fails. So I'm gonna make a little note of that. This one's not factorable. So what do? We turn to the calculator. Now, I'm only gonna go through this one time. It's a skill we've practiced quite a bit, but if I pull up my calculator, there it is. If I pull up my calculator here, I'm gonna type that function into the y equals menu. So I've got x to the third plus 6x squared plus 21x plus 26. And I'm gonna look at the table, that's second and graph. And I just wanna look for what values of x produce a zero output. And there's one, x equals negative 2. So here's how we're going to show that. We are going to say, via calc table, x equals negative 2. Now, what I cannot have you do is just say, oh, via calc table, I got all these zeros. We have to have some justification for our work. So if those answers are unsupported by something like synthetic division, you will not receive full credit. So here we said calculator table produced x equals negative 2 as a solution. We're going to run through synthetic with that. And this will confirm that answer. And if we're careful with it, it should give us a nice quadratic or something that we can work with right here that we can find our other solutions from. So I've got x squared plus 4x plus 13. That's what our quotient is from synthetic division, and we want to find out where that equals 0. So to do that, I'm going to borrow some space under problem number 6 here. To do this, 13 is a prime number. I can't find magic numbers, so this is unfactorable. Let's just turn to quadratic formula to find those remaining solutions. Opposite of b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4 times 1 times 13, that's 52. All over 2a. Let's clean up that radical. Negative 36 underneath there. 36 is a perfect square number, so I know that's 6, but it was negative, so I classify that as imaginary. And I have to divide everything by 2 if I want it fully simplified. Negative 2 plus or minus 3i. Those are my remaining two solutions. So I got 1, 2, three solutions, three zeros, for that third degree polynomial. All right, now, hopefully if we need to go back and look at that work, we can go back in the video. I just need this space to do problem number 6. I wanted to fit it on as few slides as possible. So for problem number 6, it's a fourth degree polynomial. We have no way of factoring that. So we have to use our calculator table. So number 6 is also not factorable. Via calc table, and realize this is all work for problem number 6, even though I'm way over here under problem number 5. We're not looking at that one anymore. From my calculator table, I found that x equals negative 1 is a 0. And you're able to box that up. We just have to back it up with some synthetic to confirm that it is, in fact, a 0, which is nice because we need synthetic to break that polynomial down further anyway. So 1, negative 6, 12, positive 6, negative 13. All right. Let's run through our synthetic. All right, so that one is confirmed, that x equals negative 1. However, what I'm left with represents x to the third minus 7x squared plus 19x minus 13, and I want to find out where that equals 0. That I cannot factor by grouping. So here I'm going to have to use synthetic again. So I will say at this point, via calc table, is there another zero that works with this polynomial? And I find that x equals 1 is a solution. And let's repeat that process. So 1 goes into the box for synthetic. I've got 1, negative 7, 19, negative 13. And it checks out. Okay, good. So we've defended that answer with some synthetic division. Now we simply have to find out where this equals 0. All right, and it's not factorable yet again, kind of like number 5 was. So this is a case where, again, we'll turn to quadratic formula. Opposite of b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4 times a times c, that's 52, all over 2a. And that's 6 plus or minus the square root of negative 16 all over 2. And just going to carry this work over here where I've got some room. 6 plus or minus, again, 16 is a perfect square number. We lucked out there. It is imaginary, though, so plus or minus 4i all over 2. And 6 over 2 is 3, plus or minus 4i over 2 is 2i. There are the remaining two solutions. So hopefully these four problems, there will be four of them on your test as well. Hopefully these four problems indicate when factoring is a good option. We should always be looking for that first, but also how to support our answers that we find in a calculator. We want to embrace that technology, but we want to be sure that we're not totally reliant on it either. Big part of the test happening here. So we want to be sure we have this skill down without a doubt. Right, let's move on. Next, construct a polynomial with lead coefficient 1 that has the following zeros. So number 7, notice that we have an irrational solution here. This is one solution, 1 minus root 7. That is a single zero. I need to include its conjugate pair, 1 plus root 7. And how we set this up, we need to set up factors that we can then FOIL together. And to set up a factor, it's just x minus whatever zero I see. First, x minus a negative 2. Next, x minus 1 minus root 7. And finally, x minus 1 plus root 7. All right, when we're multiplying these together, I strongly encourage you to FOIL together your irrational or imaginary conjugate pairs first. You'll get a ton of terms canceling there, that really makes the work easier from there on out. So let's see. I've got to take this x and multiply it by everything in that second grouping. So I've got x times x, x times negative 1, and x times root 7. You could call that root 7x as well. Then I multiply the negative 1 times everything in that second grouping. So minus x plus 1 minus root 7. And then finally, multiply that negative root 7 times everything. Minus root 7x or x root 7 plus root 7. And then the last one is always kind of tricky. I've got a negative number, negative root 7, times a positive number, so the product will be negative. And then I'm taking root 7 times itself, which is squaring a square root. It's just a regular 7. And take a look at the cancellations that happen. Anything that has a square root 7 as a part of it should cancel out when I combine like terms. That's how conjugates work. So negative root 7, positive root 7, plus x root 7, minus x root 7, or if you call them root 7x, those are like terms, they're x terms. They cancel out. So I'm at this point, x plus 2 times x squared minus 2x, and I have plus 1 minus 7 minus 6. And we just have to FOIL what remains. Okay, right? So I'm going to take this x times everything over here, and then take this 2 times everything over here. Okay, and I get another cancellation, which is really slick, right? I get my x squared terms cancel out. Final answer, x to the third minus 10x minus 12 when I combine all those like terms together. And take a look, I started off with 1, 2, 3 zeros. My answer is a third degree polynomial. That makes sense. For problem number 8, we've got an imaginary 0, negative 7i. Remember, those come in pairs. So positive 7i is also a 0. Plus or minus have to be included. Let's set up our factors. X minus 4, x minus negative 7i, x minus 7i. Let's FOIL those imaginary factors together first. Okay, then the last times last, when I FOIL these out, it's a positive times a negative. 7 times 7 is 49, and I times I is I squared. Now this term is really saying negative 49 times negative 1. Remember, I squared is negative 1, so that's really a plus 49 at the end of that. And just like with all of our square roots canceling, when I combine like terms, all my regular I terms cancel out. So x minus 4 times x squared plus 49 is what I'm left with. Let's FOIL that out. So that should be x to the cube, x cubed, or x to the third power. Okay, outside, inside, and last, negative 4 times positive 49, that'll be negative 196. I believe, right? 116, 36. Yeah. Let's put that in standard form just so we are sure that the degree is properly shown. And what do you know? We had 1, 2, 3 zeros, and we ended up with a third degree polynomial. The fundamental theorem backs up our answer. Next, number 9, describe the transformations that are happening when we take this graph of g. How is it moving away from its parent function? So there's quite a few things happening here. The nice thing is about this problem, it's all content that we've covered multiple times throughout the year already. So first, I notice there's a negative sign out front. That's what we've called a vertical flip. And I'm fine if you use that in this class. However, we do want to know the technical language as well. It's a reflection over the x-axis. Next, we have a 2 out front. Multiplied out in front. It's not part of our input. It's part of what's happening to that something cubed. So this, we called it 2 times as tall, but the technical term is a vertical stretch by a factor of 2. Then I notice that inside with my input, I have 1/3 times that input. We called that 1/3 as fast. But it actually means a horizontal stretch. By a factor of 3. Remember, that's that bizarro world concept we talked about earlier in the year. The fact that it's going 1/3 as fast means that it's actually spreading out over our x-axis. And then lastly, that plus 1 is a shift up 1 unit. All right, so describing the transformations, again, just identifying what are those key adjustments that are made from the parent function that's just a regular x to the third. That's what all those numbers do. 12 and 13, here we are writing a rule applying transformations to a function. Well, let's take a look. Number 12, we're starting off with this. We are translating it 4 units right and 9 units up. So our function g, to go 4 units to the right, I need to adjust the input by subtracting 4. And then I need to add 9 afterwards to raise it 9 units up. So then g of x, what is function f? It's 2 times my input squared minus 11, and then I added 9 afterwards. So we substitute in that new input, and then we tack on the plus 9 afterwards. And lastly, we just need to combine any like terms that may clean up that answer at all. So g of x equals 2 times x minus 4 to the second minus 2 is our final answer. You do not need to FOIL out x minus 4 to the second or anything like that, but just basic simplifying, like combining like terms, or if there was any distributing to do, that's what we would want to handle. Number 13, here we've got a followed by, so there's an order that these adjustments are being made. So I don't want to start off by calling that first aspect, that horizontal shrink, the first transformation, I don't want to call that g, that's my final answer. So the first step is to shrink that horizontally by a factor of 1/3. So that means I'm going to take f and make it go 3 times as fast. That will shrink it horizontally. What that looks like in our function is we take 12 times this new input to the fifth minus 9 times this new input and then minus 5. Remember, the new input applies, that 3x applies wherever there was an x in the original. Okay, I'm going to leave that like as it stands right now. Maybe I'll tidy it up just a touch by calling it 27x minus 5, because that's a pretty easy, again, distribution, multiplication, pretty easy cleanup step to do. All right. Followed by a translation 7 units down. Here's where we get to our final answer, g of x. I'm going to take that h of x that I just constructed and subtract 7. That means I'm going to take this 12 times 3x all raised to the fifth minus 27x minus 5, and I'm going to lower it 7 units. Final answer, 12 times 3x to the fifth minus 27x minus 12. Now, I probably would not take points off. Looking at this, I probably would not take points off if you left that as negative 9 times 3x, if the 3x was in parentheses. That gets the point across that it's still moving one, you know, 3 times as fast to have that horizontal shrink by 1/3. But that's how we carry that problem out. The next problem, using calculator skills primarily, we're going to graph the function and identify the intercepts, maximum and minimum points. This is that calc menu in the calculator. So let's explore what this function looks like in our calculator. And then I can revisit how to find, how to use that calculate menu, because it does play a big role in this section. So in our y equals, let's clear out what was already there. We've got 4x to the fourth, not plus, minus 21x squared, and then plus 5. I'm going to look at the graph of that function, and you can see that we've got some valleys, it looks like, on the graph that are going off the screen. That's okay. We could also do like a zoom fit or something if we would like, but we can get the idea here. So the first thing I'm looking for are the x-intercepts. So in looking at the graph, it looks like I have a crossing right here, and then some symmetry here and here. So I'm going to hit second trace to open up the calculate menu, and I'm going to choose a 0. Now you could type in the x and the x values that you want the calculator to scan in between. And I'm going to choose to do that. I've got, let's see, negative 1, negative 2, negative 3. So I want it to start scanning when x is negative 3. And I want it to stop scanning, let's see, negative 1, when x is negative 1. How about that? So it's going to scan in between those two places for a 0. That should hopefully pinpoint that one. It asks for a guess, but I can just hit enter, and it'll zoom in on that answer. So I've got negative 2.236. All right. On your test, you'll want to round these to the nearest tenth, I believe, if I remember the instructions correctly. So I just want to have the point negative 2.2, 0. All right. And from there, we would repeat that same process for each of the following zeros. And we come up with the following. Negative 0.5, 0, positive 0.5, 0, and positive 2.2, 0. Okay. Next, the maximum point. Let's open up our calculator again. It's a similar process. Now I'm looking for this peak right here that's happening in the center. So again, second trace to open up calculate. We're going to look for a maximum this time. So I'll go down to option 4 and hit enter. My left bound and right bound, it looks like going from x equaling negative 1 to positive 1 will be a good choice. So negative 1 to positive 1. And I'm just going to hit enter to go through that guess. And here it's showing me a decimal e to the negative 6. That's the calculator's way of saying I can get really close to 0, but not get it to work out exactly. For our purposes, that is 0. So 0 comma 5 is that maximum point. For the minimum, we're going to carry out the same procedure. And I know my minimum has to be happening somewhere over here. So let's do second trace to open up the calculate menu. Go down to minimum. For left bound, I'm going to do, let's see, negative 1, 2, 3. Let's go from negative 3 again to, well, probably 0, actually. So I'll have it scan between those values, and I get negative 1.6. Okay, I also need to grab the output out of that. There's negative 1.6, negative 22.6. All right, and if I did the same procedure, I've already got these worked out, I get positive 1.6, positive 22.6. Now, in this case, we had a symmetrical graph. That will not always happen. So don't think that just because you found one minimum point, all of the others will be the same way. We want to calculate each one individually. I'm just saving a little bit of time on this calculator problem in the video, hopefully. I'm already at 32 minutes. All right, so drawing our graph, I'm actually going to scale this because my minimum points are at like negative 22.6. I'm going to scale this by twos. So I had that 0.05. So my x-axis is still going to count by one, but my y-axis will count by two. You should not have to do this on the test. Everything should fit on the grid nicely. But this is a good exercise. So I had at negative 2.2, we had a 0, a negative 1/2, positive 1/2, and at positive 2.2. So I'll plot those zeros, the maximum. The minimum was negative 1.6, and it was negative 22.6. That would be just off the graph down here, like so. And then we know the ends of the graph have to rise, or we could use our table to fill in the other values, but I get a graph that kind of looks like this. There we go. Now, where is it increasing and where is it decreasing? This graph is increasing wherever it is sloping up as we read it from left to right. So there are two places where that graph is increasing. The first one is between my minimum and maximum. So when x is between negative 1.6 and 0, that's where I saw it increasing. And then it's also increasing as soon as I get past that second minimum point. So whenever x is greater than 1.6. Then for the decreasing, again, reading it left to right, it's sloping down, then we had it increase, then it's sloping down again, and then it increased. So those two regions I've emphasized with the black marker, that's the decreasing. When x is to the left of that first minimum, and when x is between 0 and that second minimum point at 1.6. Notice you're using the same numbers that you found in the calculator for max and min. You don't have to calculate anything else to answer the increasing, decreasing. Next, find f of negative x to determine whether the function is even, odd, or neither. For number 15, when I find f of negative x, that's negative x to the third minus 7 times negative x. If I clean that up, an odd power will not strip away the negative from that input, so it stays as negative x to the third. And then negative 7 times negative x is positive 7x. So first I'm going to look for even. Does that f of negative x I just found, does it perfectly match what I started with? No, it does not. So it's not even. Then, to test for odd, does that f of negative x I just found, does that equal the negative version of what I started with? Ah, and take a look. Yes, it does, because the negative version of what I started with would switch the signs on every term. And that is what I have, so this is an odd function. There's not a lot of mathematics work to do here. It's just comparisons and knowing what comparisons to look for. All right, for number 16, I'm carrying out the same thing, finding f of negative x. Okay, and I get this result. So first, let's test for even. Does that perfectly equal what I started with? No, it does not, so it's not even. Not a perfect match. Then, does what I just found equal the negative version of what I started with? It does not. Right? If I were to switch the signs on everything I started with, that's not what I found. Not a perfect match. So this is a neither even nor odd function. And our finite differences, our final problem here, determine the degree of the function, then use your calculator regression to find that. Let's go through these steps one more time. Finite differences, let's check our x row in this table. Are they counting by equal increments each time? Yes, they are. They're counting up by ones as I move across that row of x values. So I'm going to test and see, is that a first degree polynomial by doing second minus first for each set of outputs. So 15 minus 6 is 9, 22 minus 15 is 7, 21 minus 22 is negative 1, 6 minus 21 is negative 15, and negative 29 minus 6 is negative 35. Those numbers did not match, so it's not a first degree polynomial. Right, maybe it's a second degree. So I'm going to take those numbers that I just found and carry out subtractions again. 7 minus 9, negative 2. Negative 1 minus 7, negative 8. Negative 15 minus negative 1. And negative 35 minus negative 15. Those numbers do not match. It's not a second degree polynomial. Maybe it's a third degree. Let's try the third difference. Oops, I can't put an x or anything there yet. I haven't tested it yet. Maybe it's a third degree polynomial. Negative 8 minus negative 2. Negative 14 minus negative 8. Negative 20 minus negative 14. It is a third degree polynomial. So I know that this is a third degree polynomial, and I'm going to use calculator regression to actually find that polynomial. It's very calculator intensive work, but the nice thing is we don't have to grind it out by hand. All right, so let's go back to our home screen. I'm going to hit the stat key, and then I'm just going to hit enter. I want to edit the stats, and you may have to clear out some lists that are already there. List one is going to contain all of my x values. So negative 3, negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, 2. For list two, those are going to be all of my outputs, again in order so they match up. 6, 15, 22, 21, 6, and negative 29. Just do a quick check to make sure that, first of all, we typed them in properly, and that we have equal numbers of elements in list one and two. Then we're going to hit stat again, and we're going to toggle over to calculate, and we know third degree from our difference work over there that this is going to be a cubic regression, option 6. So we'll go down until it says calculate, and hit enter, or just hit enter if you have an older calculator like this one. And there is our cubic. We just have to put that together into a polynomial. So what is that polynomial? What am I writing down for my final answer here? It is y equals, or I guess they're calling it f of x in our table, so we should call that f of x as well. We had negative 1x to the third minus 7, that's our x squared term, minus 7 again, that's our x term, and then plus 21. So that's what we're putting for our final answer, but realize we are asked to use finite differences. We need to show this work as well. We cannot just go right to the calculator regression. We have to back that up with some actual thought of our own. All right, I do apologize, this was a longer video, but at the same time, there's a lot to talk about. And when you sit down to actually do this work, it is kind of an arduous task. So I hope that this video has helped to kind of condense these ideas, all this analyzing functions and coming up with the regressions. I hope we have a better feel for what we've covered this chapter and that we're prepared for this test. Happy studying, everybody.